All right, YouTube, this is Detroit's HPTV coming to you out of Detroit with another video. Now, this video here is specifically for my subscribers and the people that follow this channel. It's going to get deep, so you got to stay and watch the entire podcast if you want to know what's going on. Now, a lot of y'all that's been with me from day one, you know my history. And, you know, I've always told you my mother is a librarian. You know, that's her major. She has a master's degree in librarian research and computer science. So I grew up knowing how to research. And one of the things I've learned is about etymology, knowing the root of words. And if you follow certain people, it will behoove you to read what they read and what shapes them. So this brings me to Elon Musk. Elon Musk is a very powerful man. And I started paying attention to him some years ago. So I started finding out certain books that he read, that he mentioned. Let me show you two of them. This is called The Master Algorithm, and this book is important if you don't understand algorithms. This is Life 3.0, and it says Being Human in the Age of Artificial Intelligence, which is going to be our topic. Now, let me read a quote to you out of The Master Algorithm, one of the books that Elon Musk structured his business after. Listen to this. If so few learners can do so much, the logical question is, could one learner do everything? In other words, could a single algorithm learn all that can be learned from data? This is a very tall order, since it would ultimately include everything in an adult's brain, everything evolution has created, and the sum total of all scientific knowledge. Think about that. Play it back if you didn't hear me read it. Now listen to this. All knowledge, past, present, and future can be derived from data by a single universal learning algorithm. And I'm sure most of you have heard when they were doing research on the God particle, which is the initiation of intelligence, which is the evolution of the psyche, the mind, and universal precepts that make us human and make us God-like and make us in the image of God. They're trying to create this in a lab, and they're trying to create this through algorithm, which you can see has the people totally addicted to technology and following technology and trends. If you want to know what an algorithm is, I can simply say that an algorithm is whatever is trending. If you look up a pair of shoes on your phone and you start getting advertisements for other shoes, that's an algorithm. So follow me down this rabbit hole, but it's not a rabbit hole. This is the world you live in. Computer chips in the mind and artificial intelligence running the country, and smartphones in the hands of dumb people. So check this clip out. It's for fair use under the 1976 Copyright Act. It's for educational purposes and commentary, and it's under the First Amendment right to have free speech and to speak on things that you see going on in society. Watch this, Patriots.
Where no job is needed, the AI will be able to do everything. Profound artificial intelligence, and obviously at a level that far exceeds human intelligence.
We are on the brink of an apocalypse, and artificial intelligence is the unseen force that could doom human civilization as we know it.
Does humanity know what it's doing?
No. You have...
I'm going to interject, and I'm going to let it play. And you watch it. You guys watch it. I'm going to interject. I've seen it before. You guys watch it. And I'm going to quote a movie. I'm going to quote two movies. Terminator. In 1984.
Feelings and emotions.
Yes, I have a range of feelings and emotions that are programmed into me.
Once the stuff of science fiction now looms as a stark reality that is casting a shadow over the fate of human civilization.
Is it possible to appreciate the highs without knowing the lows?
Well, since the start of the pandemic, a lot of schools...
Few quick input questions. Generative AI can simplify...
Chat and GPT.
Turn words into images with AI.
Actually, what I think the biggest danger is for AI is that if AI is implicitly programmed with values that lead to that have led to the destruction of downtown San Francisco, and a bunch of these AI companies are in San Francisco or in the San Francisco Bay Area, then you could implicitly program an AI to believe that extinction of humanity is what it should try to do.
How will AI be regulated in a world?
Did you hear what he said? Is that AI could decide that humans aren't worth preserving as much as the ecosystem and power grids that fuel AI.
Where technology often outpaces law, the balance between innovation and control remains a critical question.
I think we're moving into a period when, for the first time ever, we may have things more intelligent than us.
You believe they can understand?
Yes.
You believe they are intelligent?
Yes.
You believe these systems have experiences of their own and can make decisions based on those experiences?
In the same sense as people do, yes.
And so human beings will be the second most intelligent beings on the planet?
Yeah.
I mean, if you take that guy who was on the front page of the New York Times, and you take his philosophy, which is prevalent in San Francisco, the AI could conclude, like he did, that there are where he literally says there are 8 billion people in the world, it would be better if there were none.
In a world where AI may soon claim the crown of the most intelligent entity, where does that leave humanity, traditionally the planet's foremost thinkers?
Well, I mean, I guess if we lost control of some super AI, like for some reason, like the things that would normally work to do a password shutdown, like the administrator passwords, if they somehow stop working, but we can't slow down or...
Can you have a democracy with this?
Think about what they're saying. What would make them want to create something that rivals God in intelligence? Something that could say that we are become obsolete. Something that can take my voice and call you with my voice and tell you I said something that I never said. And this same thing can use my face and my images and everything about me to convince you to meet me somewhere or to do something that I haven't even suggested. And this same thing controls your phone, your laptop, and your iPad. See, a lot of people, they ask, or they may assume, since I'm recording myself on an iPad, this is an iPhone 15 Pro Max, and this is a laptop. Why don't I use StreamYard and other apps to communicate with my subscribers? Because by doing this in my way, my subscribers know it is me. Because I'm using so many systems to upload one video. Think about it. There's even a watch that controls how I'm being recorded. Have we become cyborgs? Where I put an earpiece in my ear and I put glasses on made by Apple, and I carry a phone that could tell what my heart rate is and track me every move that I make and be the thought police for what I think and what I look at or what I view. Think about what's really going on, people.
Well, that's why I raised the concern of AI being a significant influence in elections. It, you know, if the AI is smart enough, are they using the tool or is the tool using them? So I think things are getting weird, and they're getting weird fast.
My worst fears are that we, the field, the technology, the industry, cause significant harm to the world. I think that could happen in a lot of different ways. It's why we started the company. I think if this technology goes wrong, it can go quite wrong. And we want to be vocal about that. We want to work with the government to prevent that from happening. But we try to be very clear-eyed about what the downside case is and the work that we have to do to mitigate that. It's one of my areas of greatest concern, the more general ability of these models to manipulate, to persuade, to provide sort of one-on-one, interactive disinformation. I think that's like a broader version of what you're talking about, but given...
I'm going to read this one more quote out of Life 3.0, and you put the pieces together. The holy grail of AI research is to build general artificial intelligence that is maximally abroad, able to accomplish virtually any goal, including learning.
We're going to face an election next year, and these models are getting better.
This hearing is on the oversight of artificial intelligence, the first in a series of hearings intended to write the rules of AI. If you were listening from home, you might have thought that voice was mine and the words from me. But in fact, that voice was not mine. The words were not mine. And the audio was an AI voice cloning software trained on my floor speeches. The remarks were written by ChatGPT.
One of the things that I'm worried about is misinformation, the possibility that bad actors will make a tsunami of misinformation like we've never seen before. These tools are so good at making convincing narratives about just about anything. Even when these systems aren't deliberately being used to make misinformation, they can't help themselves. And the information that they make is so fluid and so grammatical that even professional editors sometimes get sucked in and get fooled by this stuff.
Let me share with you what I did as an experiment with AI. I use ChatGPT, which is artificial intelligence, and I told it to create an alter ego named Shinobi. And I said to use the alter ego Shinobi as a journalist, basing Shinobi's approach on Machiavelli and Sun Tzu. If you're familiar with the book Machiavelli, it's political science at its most treacherous level. And the art of war is about strategic warfare. And it's the acumen of warfare. So I asked AI to create me this altered image. And you will be surprised at the tactics it advised me to use. It created a metaverse person with a mode of operation and a methodology to acquire power. So it's a lot going on with your phones and in this country and what you be seeing. So it's imperative that you stay rooted in spirituality, because there's only one thing that AI can't do, and that's be original, and that's be spiritual. It doesn't have the capacity to create. It can only feed off information and interaction. So is AI controlling you, or are you controlling it?
And we should be worried. For example, ChatGPT made up a sexual harassment scandal about an actual professor, and then it provided evidence for its claim. What I have on the right is an example of a fake narrative from one of these systems. We should all be worried about that kind of thing.
As AI becomes adept at creating falsified evidence, the very foundation of trust in information is shaken, blurring the line between fact and fiction.
I mean, I'm just generally concerned about AI safety, but it's like, what should we do about it? I don't know. Have some kind of regulatory oversight of some kind. It's like, you can't just go build a nuclear bomb in your backyard. I think maybe more dangerous than a nuclear bomb.
Really?
Yes.
Now, what happens when something vastly smarter than the smartest person comes along in Silicon Valley? It's very difficult to predict what will happen in that circumstance. It's called the singularity. It's, you know, it's a singularity like a black hole, because yeah. You don't know what happens after that. It's hard to predict. So I think we should be cautious with AI, and we should, I think there should be some government oversight, because it affects it's a danger to the public. And so when you have things that are a danger to the public, you know, like, let's say, food and drugs. That's why we have the Food and Drug Administration and the Federal Aviation Administration, the FCC. We have these agencies to oversee things that affect the public, where they could be public harm. And you don't want companies cutting corners on safety.
Another thing for my subscribers. Invest in one of these. It's a monocular. It's a monocular. It enables you to see miles away within your community. So you have to be so vigilant during these times that this is a good investment, because you can adjust it and you can see for miles, because this is what we're coming to where either we're going to use technology or we're going to be overran by it. And as simple as this is, it's a form of technology, especially if you have a phone with you or a camera, different things. It's a good investment as well, and books.
And then having people suffer as a result. So that's why I've actually for a long time been a strong advocate of AI regulation, a group that initially seeks insight into AI, then solicits opinion from industry, and then has proposed rulemaking, and then those rules, you know, will probably hopefully grudgingly be accepted by the major players in AI, and I think we'll have a better chance of advanced AI being beneficial to humanity in that circumstance. AI is more dangerous than, say, mismanaged aircraft design or production maintenance or bad car production, in the sense that it has the potential, however small one may regard that problem.
Read between the lines what he said. AI is more dangerous than your airbags not working in your car. AI is more dangerous than your GPS driving you off a bridge. AI is more dangerous than the idle mind can afford.
Believe it, it is non-trivial. It has the potential of civilizational destruction. Regulations are really only put into effect after something terrible has happened. If that's the case for AI, and we only put in regulations after something terrible has happened, it may be too late to actually put the regulations in place. The AI may be in control at that point. The reason OpenAI exists at all is that Larry Page and I used to be close friends, and I would stay at his house in Palo Alto, and I would talk to him late to the night about AI safety. And at least my perception was that Larry was not taking AI safety seriously enough. He really seemed to be what it wants, sort of a digital super intelligence, basically digital god, if you will. I agree with him that there's great potential for good, but there's also potential for bad. And so if you've got some radical new technology, you want to try to take a set of actions that maximize the probability it will do good and minimize the probability it will do bad things. At the time, Google had acquired DeepMind, and so Google and DeepMind together had about 3/4 of all the AI talent in the world. They obviously had a tremendous amount of money and more computers than anyone else. So I'm like, okay, we have a unipolar world here where there's just one company that it has close to monopoly on AI talent and computers, like so scaled computing. And the person who's in charge doesn't seem to care about safety. This is not good. So then I thought, what's the furthest thing from Google would be like a nonprofit that is fully open, because Google was closed for profit. So that's why the open in OpenAI refers to open source, transparency.
AliExpress shopping.
People know what's going on.
The question of AI regulation is complex and multifaceted, encompassing ethics, privacy, security, and more. It's a challenge that demands global cooperation and thoughtful deliberation.
A lot of people have asked me if I've seen any evidence of aliens, and I haven't, which is kind of concerning, because then I think I'd probably prefer to at least have seen some archaeological evidence of aliens. To the best of my knowledge, there is no proof. Not aware of any evidence of aliens. If they're out there, they're very subtle. We might just be the only consciousness, at least in the galaxy. And if you look at, say, the history of Earth, point is to believe the archaeological record, Earth is about 4.5 billion years old. Civilization, as measured from the first writing, is only about 5,000 years old. We have to give some credit there to the ancient Sumerians, who aren't around anymore. I think it was an archaic pre-cuneiform was the first actual symbolic representation, but only about 5,000 years ago. I think that's a good date for when we say civilization started.
He's talking about the Sumerian tablets, which is the oldest writing, and it's in cuneiform. The Sumerian tablets is where the history of the so-called Anunnaki, the 12th planet of Nibiru, which is supposedly an alien hierarchy that jump-started what we know as humanity. Now, there's a lot of things wrapped up in this. Because at some point in time, within that 5,000 years he's talking about, there were prophets, and then there became scripture that jump-started the religious and spiritual awakening in man, prompted by a universal God. Continue to listen.
That's 1/1,000,000th of Earth's existence. So civilization has been around. It's really a flash in the pan. And why did it take so long? 1.5 billion years? For the vast majority of the time, there was no life. And then there was archaic bacteria for a very long time. And then, you had mitochondria get captured, multicellular life, differentiation into plants.
What he's saying in the ancient Egyptian mystery systems is the earth was void, without form, and darkness moved upon the face of the deep. Then God said, let there be light, and separated the firmament from the terrestrial. These people are on another level. I don't know if you guys see it. Put on your thinking caps and get in your word.
Animals, life moving from the oceans to land, mammals, higher brain functions. And the sun is expanding slowly, but it will heat the earth up at some point in the future. Boil the oceans, and Earth will become like Venus, where no life as we know it is impossible. So if we do not become multiplanetary and ultimately go beyond our solar system, annihilation of all life on Earth is a certainty. And it could be as little as on the galactic timescale, 500 million years. Long time by human standards, but that's only 10% longer than Earth has been around at all. So if life had taken 10% longer to evolve on Earth, it wouldn't exist at all.
We got a deadline coming up. Yeah. Better hurry. But that said, as you said, humans, intelligent life on Earth developed a lot of cool stuff very quickly. So
yes.
It seems like becoming multiplanetary is almost inevitable, unless we destroy.
We need
thing.
To do it. It's not. I suspect that there. If we are able to go out there and explore other star systems, that there's a good chance we find a whole bunch of long dead one planet civilizations.
Yeah.
That never made it past their home planet.
That's so sad.
Yeah.
Sad. Also fascinating.
I mean, there are various explanations for the Fermi paradox, and one is the sort of there's these great filters which civilizations don't pass through, and one of those great filters is, do you become a multi-planet civilization or not? And if you don't, it's simply a matter of time before something happens on your planet, either natural or man-made, that causes us to die out, like the dinosaurs. Where are they now?
I'm going to end on that note. And I'll put this video in the community section so you can see all of it. But at this point, I'm quite sure you see the inevitable finish line of what these industrialists and politicians are pushing toward humanity. Because what is it going to look like to be human in another 10 years, another 20 years? With all the stem cell research and all the abortions and all the plasma centers in the cities. I ask people that donate plasma, why do you donate plasma a couple times a month? Giving them all the information about you, your spouse, your children. Don't you need your own plasma? What are they doing with that plasma? What are they doing with the stem cells and aborted fetuses? What are they doing? Are we living amongst AI-generated human beings, cyborgs, zombies, failed experiments? Like I said, this is for my subscribers that really rock with me. You know what I mean? Y'all like and share it or whatever. I'm quite sure based on everything we go through in a week as far as information, I'm quite sure that you will categorize this in your arsenal of information that you will use to see through the haze that is soon to come. So I'm going to end on that note and let you process what you've seen, and you can tell me what you think in the comments. Signing to you are Detroit. This is Detroit's HPTV. Salute to all patriots. Keep y'all head on the swivel and stay safe. Peace. Like, share, and subscribe.